I design drones for the Pentagon in the United States. I have one drone. The drone application is used in all the Pentagon platforms.
And you designed it?
I designed it.
And if you don't know his name, you're about to find out exactly who Dr. Thomas Mensah is.
Hey, darlings, and welcome back yet to another interesting, intriguing, and most importantly, educative, expository, informative, and mind-blowing episode right here on the Stable of Vibes Upon Vibes with Chivik.
Burn out of curiosity, burn out of passion, and the ability of wanting to know more, to explore. I really had to go into research of who are those people that are preeminent, that are outstanding, unique, and have impacted in the motherland Ghana, even though they are no more in existence. And I bumped into this very exceptional, intelligent, brave, and daring when it comes to daring into science and exploring science and a lot. This same man we are about to take a look at, a clear picture, knowledge, and understanding of, is a man that has really impacted also in so many aspects in the motherland. And we need to, ladies and gentlemen, recognize him both in his absentia. And with this, I bring to you a great hero, like a scientist and more from the motherland. This is definitely going to be me reacting to a video of a creative. Yes, credit to him who interviewed this man you're about to see now, and he told us a lot. He said a lot that I do not need to explain. Let's take a look at everything that transpired, and we'll be right back.
I designed drones for the Pentagon in the United States. I have one drone. The drone application is used in all the Pentagon platforms.
And you designed it?
I designed it.
And if you don't know his name, you're about to find out exactly who Dr. Thomas Mensah is. He's known as the engineer who transformed and revolutionized the internet. He is an engineer who has 14 patents. Am I correct? 14
yes.
Patents. And responsible for inventing the fiber optics that we rely upon today. Dr. Mensah, it is a pleasure. It's an honor. To have you here on Maximum Impact, and I'm almost speechless, because I understand who you are and how you've influenced everything, all the technology that we have right in front of us, you have played a part in. So tell me a little bit how you got started as a child in STEM technology during a time when STEM technology was not at the forefront of the industry.
Jay, I'm excited to be on your show. Very excited, because you have a very popular show. So I'm excited. Come and do two things.
All right.
Talk about The Rise That Comes in Black, which is my book.
Okay.
Talk about how we invented fiber optics. Jay, there are four of us that did the work. Three white Americans.
Okay.
And Dr. Thomas Mensah from Ghana. We created fiber optics. And so when you're sitting down, Jay, or anybody, sending pictures, YouTube pictures, sending pictures to Facebook, to any place. When you press send, and the picture is in China, it's because of us.
Wow.
When you press send, in a few seconds, it's in South Africa, or it's even in Ghana.
Yes.
You know, or in America, it's because of what we did.
Now, what was it like sitting down and coming up with fiber optics? How did it even come to you, your mind, to do this? Because—
Well, that's a good question. As you know, first of all, you mentioned how did I start? My dad used to sit me on his lap and read to me newspapers. So Jay, I was reading newspapers flawlessly at the age of four.
At the age of four.
You know, like what you do and all that.
Yes, newspapers. Yes.
My next door neighbor, Jay, came from Togo teaching French in Ghana. Hanging with him at 8 years old, I was speaking French fluently. Yes, listening to the radio and all. So that's how it started. And so when I went to a disco at the Sada College, a lot of famous people went there. The French were still watching me when I was there. You know, hey, this is a guy probably we can even send to France.
Ah, okay.
You know, so that you can buy Boeing, instead of Boeing, buy Airbus planes from us. Do the tri-gravity test, the fast streams from us. So the French had their own reason for, you know, watching me all the way till I went to KNUST, Kwame Nkrumah University. The day I was graduating, K, the French said, this is a full scholarship, one-way ticket to France, don't do side job, focus on your studies. So I went to France, Paris first, Montpellier University, where I was, That's where Airbus is.
That's where, okay, Airbus is there, okay.
Airbus is in Toulouse. Okay. Yeah, Toulouse, yeah. And so it was a big, you know, opportunity you have to grab.
You have to grab it. You have to grab it.
Oh, yeah. So I was working hard and I came on top. You know. But just before I finished in France, my dad came to Montpellier and said, hey, Doc, when you come to Ghana, I'll be happy.
Mm-hmm.
But coup d'etat by shampoo and all that, don't come to Ghana yet. Go to the United States. That was the best advice I ever had.
So because of what was going on, you were in France, and then it was a coup d'etat happening here in Ghana.
Yes.
And then that's when your dad came, and he said, go to the U.S.
Yes.
And so you went to the U.S.
Yes.
All right, what happened next?
Yeah. So I had a scholarship to U.S., you know, to go to MIT.
MIT, okay.
Top university, as you know.
Yes.
In the world, in engineering and science. So when I went to MIT, they got a call from Corning Glass Works, where fiber optics was being developed. Can MIT send us one of your top engineers to help us, you know, get it out of their lab?
And what year was this?
Oh, I sit on the board at MIT even now.
Okay.
Yeah. And so I went to Corning Glass Works, and they put me in charge of the program to take it out of the lab. So in 1985, I had my first patent.
So 1985, your first patent.
Yes.
And that was when you were at MIT working with Corning Glass Works.
Yes.
Got it.
So the patent was taking the invention out of the lab and putting it to commercialization. So my first patent allowed fiber optics to be made instead of 2 meters a second, to be made at 20 meters a second.
Hmm.
And this is the commercialization. I received Corning Glass Works individual outstanding contributor award from Corning.
Because you were able to increase the speed of the fiber optics to 20 meters a second.
Yeah, from two.
Wow.
That was a game changer.
Yes, I'm, yes.
Japan, the whole world, they were looking at me, wow, hey, Dr. Mensah, this is serious. So you told me competing with us in Japan, I said, man, we can't match that. So guess what? He stayed in the lab for 15 years, Jay. In 1 year, I solved the problem.
Hmm.
1 year.
So when you came on board, you solved the problem that they've been trying to solve for 15 years within 1 year. You did that within 1 year. Did you face any challenges? Because when I say this, recognizing 1985, around that time, did they have a lot of people who looked like you in that industry?
I'm the only black person. African, Ghanaian.
Yes, yes.
In charge of the program.
In charge of the program.
Yeah. White people working for me, reporting to me.
How did that go? How did that work out for you?
The draw tower.
Okay.
So I 4 stories high. Cost $5 million. I am in charge.
In 1985.
Yes. And my first patent, they filed it just like that. Fastest patent to receive by anybody.
Really?
I got it in 6 months.
This is a story that most people, again, like I said, they don't know.
No.
And they don't understand the influence of those who have paved the way, because that's what you did. You paved the way, because with that first patent happening, and people, a lot of times, you know, people don't understand what patents are and how they work. So that was your first patent. You have 14 patents.
Yes. So, actually, in addition to that, I 7 of the 14 patents were received in 6 years.
So that's unheard of.
Unheard of.
So what made what you did so special and so unique that they would fast track these patents?
Well, because number one, you come in, you know, I took video pictures of the applicator.
Oh, okay.
And it was studying the day and night. As I said, other than the bullet training gun, that's the hardest work I did. Day and night.
So Ghana prepared you for this.
So I'm working day and night. Change the applicator, I said, watching it, I said, oh, that's the problem. The redistribution of the coating around the glass, you know, fiber optics is actually a glass, right?
Okay.
With coating on it. But the distribution of the coating was not even. I saw that in the videos.
And that's how you
redesigned the applicator.
Okay.
So that it's uniform.
Okay.
That's all the problem.
So with that, you're solving all of these problems.
Yes.
How did the And I don't know if this how you feel comfortable me asking this question. Did they compensate you properly for your work?
Well, I would say yes.
Okay, that's what I want to know. Because we know it's business.
Oh, I know. As a matter of fact, I tell people, how did you develop Silicon Valley of Ghana? I used all those finances
in order to do that.
To create Silicon Valley of Ghana.
Wow. Now, for the young engineer that's coming along, because you see where it's happening, like you talked about, well, I sent you a picture and it happened within seconds, and I realized that I'm sending the picture to one of the people who were instrumental in being able to send a picture in the first place.
Exactly.
For the young person that's coming along in STEM, how would you encourage them at this point? Because we see where it's going, the new wave of technology, especially when we talk about Africa, West Africa, East Africa, South Africa, North Africa, Central Africa, the importance of technology now, because we see what you were able to do coming from Kumasi, Ghana, and changing the world with this. So there's another Thomas Mensah somewhere out here. How would you inspire or encourage that person?
Well, basically, I'll tell them, go to Silicon Valley of Ghana and enroll. I'm training 100 youth in Silicon Valley. The government is paying me to do that.
Okay.
Both in Accra, Kofiana ICT Center, and Kumasi. Yeah, I'm training another 100.
So
go there and roll, because the kind of things I'm teaching, I have 30 professors working with me, world famous professors. So you can teach you about drones.
All right, let's take a look here. Let's take a look. So drones. So your technology is instrumental in these drones.
Yes.
That we have flying and capturing all these shots.
Yes. Yes. Because as you see, you learn in one of the videos that have been sent out there, I designed drones for the Pentagon in the United States.
Wow. I see. I'm looking through the book.
Yeah, and so when Pentagon, I have one drone. The drone application is using all the Pentagon platforms.
And you designed it?
I designed it. I developed it.
You know, it's amazing to hear this, because we don't get to hear the backstory. We don't get to hear this side of it. You know, we just use the technology.
Yes.
And that's all we know.
Yes.
But to know a human being is a part of it. Now, did you get the recognition? Now, I've heard part of the recognition, but when we think about this, is your name right there along with your other American counterparts?
My white guys?
Yeah. I'll let you say it.
Now it's becoming.
Okay.
And luckily, since I'm the one that can narrate a link to modern day smartphones, they're all happy about it.
Okay.
You know, they were recognized, they went to the White House and all that stuff. But right now, I'm the one leading the story.
That's right. We want the world to know.
Now, you can agree with me that indeed, this is a real gem. This man is a real gem. May his soul rest in peace. I learned he has passed on. And these are the kind of people, time to time, we should give credit to, remember and acknowledge, at least that have impacted alongside so many others. So when you see videos of people like this, know that it is definitely worth it and worth talking about. We are all human beings living in the world, creating impact, some are creating negatively, while some positively. What is our result, our end result, that we impact in the world today in any way, shape or form that will stand to speak the test of time and have us being remembered, whether for good or for bad. Now the question is, having recognized this man, even in his absence, what will you be remembered for? This is a food for thought. I would not want to flog it so much. And in a nutshell, I want to say well done to a man like this. May his soul rest on and alongside other people who have impacted. And that is what we have for today. What are your thoughts? What are your opinion, your objective? If you actually did like what you have seen today, encourage by hitting on the like button, share so that more people would definitely get to know, because on here it is more of informative, educative, exposition, entertaining, and most importantly inspiring episode back to back right here on this table of Vibes Upon Vibes with Chivik. Guys, thank you once again for watching patiently up to this moment. I truly and deeply appreciate for all your likes, your support. I do not take it for granted, and do not make this your last. If this is your first time stumbling on this channel, I beg of you, kindly hit on the subscription button to become a part and parcel of this amazing, unique and wonderful people of like minds and prospects who are taking the motherland to the next level. You don't want to be left out, right? Until then, keeping it real, happy, safe and blessed, and I will see you in my next one. Do have a lovely, peaceful, a blessed and a successful day out there. Ciao ciao.